IVM.
TFG Football is an IVM production, and you can also check out their other awesome shows like Geek Fruit with fellow and television geeks Tejas, Jishnu and Dinkar as they discuss the world of science fiction and nerd culture.
You're listening to TFG Football.
Well, it's a new episode and a new day, a new week, and here we are once again bringing you all the updates of Indian football. It's the TFG Indian Football Podcast and it's time to talk about football. Well, it was a great weekend action and a lot of football happening. I am your host, Suju Matthew, who gets you everything, all the updates, who also puts Kevin's job at ease because, don't worry, Kevin, you will be hosting very soon. I'm going to go. I'm going to give you the limelight with you. And
along with you, there'll be a few listeners also who will go away.
No. That doesn't matter. I'm sure they'll be like, oh, God, thank God she's gone. So, well, I also had Chiranjeevi joining us via phone call. And what a weekend, right, boys? Amazing weekend because certain surprises, certain top, you know, topple of the points table. And guess who's sitting on the top of the points table in I-League? It's Naroka, the debutants. Drum roll, please. And crazy stuff, right? One loss can do that. That's what a loss and a win can do, right? Churchill are known. I'm going to start, you know, anyhow the way I want because that's how interesting the matches were. So I'm not going to go in any order. Churchill are known for the party poopers, you know, for second half of the season, and that's what they've been doing. I'm sure they must be having some phone call with Derek Pereira. I'm telling you, some behind-the-scenes action going on. But, Kevin, coming to you, what a match that was. 2-1 victory to Churchill, and that just put Minerva's winning run. Not just the winning run, or being, it just puts an end to for them to be on top of the points table, but not probably, not for too long, because they have a match coming up. But still, Naroka have done brilliant.
Yeah, and I you know, this is good for the league. I would say, you know, you have a little entertainment factor where things, you know, that have been working in one way. You know, there's a slight disruption and Churchill, you know, did that perfectly right. Minerva having a great run and no doubt they did put up a great performance against Churchill. It was a close game. 2-1 again suggests that it wasn't much difference between both sides, especially when you know there is a penalty involved. No, penalty always, you know, has raised eyebrows whether this was the legitimate penalty or no. Referees' decisions are always questionable, but I think coming to that penalty miss, will it hurt them for a long time is yet to see. And we've already seen Naroka taking advantage of that. It could have been 2-2, it could have been 3-2 to either ways. But final score says 2-1 to Churchill Brothers, and Churchill Brothers are that team. Though last season also, they picked up pace only after certain technical changes were made into the formation, and the positions of the players were changed, shuffled a bit. This time it's not Derek Pereira, yes, it's the Alfred. All right. I think it's a good result for Churchill Brothers because not just we're not looking just at Minerva who are trying to stay on the top. Churchill also trying to pull up themselves up from the danger zone, and luck has been on their side. Now consistently they could have got some more results in their favor, but yeah, this is where we are now. Churchill have come to a safer zone as of now, but. Let's hope for a good finish to this league. It's already okay. So excited.
Yeah, Chiranjeev. Now, great stuff, right? I mean, when you look at the three teams that are sitting on the points table, the first three. Now, Naroka got a win, Minerva lost, and East Bengal, what a thriller towards the end. they got a goal against Indian Arrows, right? To go above rivals Bagan on the points table. So, crazy stuff going on between the top three.
Yeah, well, the East Bengal versus Indian Arrows game, I thought I was watching a CFL game. You know, it's like they are taking on a team that's much less in experience, is not supposed to be a match for them, yet they just go out and put on a big-hearted show and almost hold them. But then again, in the extra time, they just do some foggy time magic and get a goal and get that win. That's the story of CFL, basically. But, it was interesting to see that happening in I-League. And it's also an indication that East Bengal are more or less back, you know, after the derby loss, after the draw against Nineveh Punjab. they more or less boiled over. We covered that whole protest thing, and even on the match day on Sunday, there was yesterday, they were holding a lot of rallies and protests from the fans who were up against the officials who did not like the way the club was being run. And this win by the skin of their teeth, it sort of gives a lifeline to their title hopes. It sort of gives a lifeline to the officials. The first one is, I think, every East Bengal fan will be glad for. The second one, I think it comes back to bite them in the ass in the long term, because every single time it happens in East Bengal and Mohun Bagan, that they just get a win, and once the team wins, you can't say anything against the people who are running the team, because the team won, so the officials get a lifeline and they can keep up their aggressive style of management for a bit longer. And if they can win a trophy, you know, that secures their future for the next 2 years.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's the dilemma of these two clubs, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah.
Yeah, but actually, the what I'm actually interested in, you know, discussing today in detail is what happened on Friday. I mean, atrocity after atrocity. I don't remember a game like this. Like the Churchill brothers, Minerva Punjab had it a little bit of that. I think Minerva Punjab were denied a penalty, and then I'm sure we'll come back to discuss this in detail. Pune City versus Kerala Blasters. Sidhu, I know you like Kerala Blasters. I don't think they deserve that win.
Of course not.
how can three penalties be denied to Pune City, and then they are given a consolation penalty that wasn't a penalty?
Yeah, I mean, it looks like you know, the referees, not just for that match. We saw it in the derby, or was it, I think it's one of the East Bengal or Bagan involved, I think it was the derby, right? So, the second derby that was played, I mean, the referee, you know, making up for the mistake that happened the first time. The first one looked like a penalty, but not given. The second one did not look like a penalty, but given because, probably I'm making up for the show that I forgot to do. So, that's how it's been,
three. In one half, two in first half, one in second half, three penalties denied to a team. How can you have that? Protests against the VAR that I hear, that it's expensive, it can hold up the game, we don't know how this will affect the entertaining factor of the match. No, man, people are out there to win. That's the primary objective of any team. And if mistakes just turn a game, like we saw, that there's just no argument that the game did not go the way it was supposed to because of those decisions. So you can't have that. It's not fair to the fans who are paying money to see it. It's not fair to the players who are putting it all out there. It's not even fair to CK Vinita and Jackie Chan Singh, who scored really good goals, and now that is being overshadowed by this bullshit conversation that we are having about the referee quality. It's not fair to anybody. It's not flattering to the leagues also. I-League is having a shit year in refereeing. ISL is having a shit year in refereeing. It just paints a very bad picture of Indian football, that tells you, like, even if you work hard, somebody in there will make a mistake and there's no way to correct it.
Yeah.
And you just end up paying for it. That's just not how it should go, Indian football.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's ridiculous because just like the Chiranjit said, we've seen some amazing goals, and, you know, because of some stupid decision on the field. And not just that, I mean, even the fans causing ruckus is kind of being a pain in the ass in this season, because, again, we saw in Pune, and Pune are known for that. The local, I don't know who it is, whether it's the actual fans who come to watch the game or the localites, because even during when Mumbai FC was there, and even when they used to go to watch Pune game, like Pune FC, this is going on since then. So whether it's a Pune FC game or DSK match, they've been disturbed, they've been hurt, they've been thrown stuff at, and that same thing happened again in Pune when after the match of Kerala Blasters. So I think it's all of these things just take away the good football that happens on the field, whether it's the referee's bad decision, whether it's these fans creating stupidity. I don't know, Kevin, what do you have to say about all these? And especially this season, it's like too much.
It's more power to the fans now. You know, they feel that there is a need for them to show their aggression in a way that disrupts their own team's feelings, or sometimes it is genuinely a mistake. So you have to take it in the spirit of the game. But fans turning up violently and showing their protests in a much more uncivilized way, it really hurts. It hurts everybody, not just the winning team or a losing team. It's just for the management of the stadium. It's just a difficult time for all. So, there are ways to protest. We've seen in the past, just for example, you just brought up the topic of Mumbai FC. Last season, we saw the protest by Mumbai FC players. It was peaceful. It was, I wouldn't say, too polite.
But that's the thing. It's not the protest here. It's just being violent and showing off your team is lost. So you want to show that to your opponent fans. But what are the fans done?
But I don't think it represents the fan culture. It's those elements, that get mixed around with the genuine fans. And they bring a bad name to the actual true supporters.
Yeah, all of these, as long as nobody's hurt off the field or on the field, things are okay. You can go on with the banter with whatever, but don't get physical out there. Your players are there to do that on the field, and certain things sometimes doesn't happen. Now, again, here, we saw again what I'm mentioning, what Chiranjeet mentioned, like two amazing goals we saw in that particular match, and that's being overshadowed with this rubbish referee talks and what happened off the field. But let's come back to good football. Shillong.
Yeah, before you do, Shiju, two things I want to point out.
Okay.
Like, I think it's very ugly what happened between the two sets of fans.
Hmm.
But I think the Pune City management should be happy that finally people are caring that their team is losing, because you don't know for sure that actual fan culture exists and not just a bunch of spectators until they get angry when their team is treated badly.
Yeah.
And it's a very I'll probably get some stick for saying this, but this is how you know that people just lose their sense of logic and act out when
not necessary.
In
a way, okay, Chiranjeet, but I would like to disagree on that point, because it's not necessary. It can be those people who
it's
just come.
It's not an excuse.
Not an excuse.
Phenomenon.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying.
Thing I wanted to sort of point out was, did you see how the coaches did? Minerva Punjab was were denied a penalty, and Khogan Singh was just he for a moment he had his head on his hand and he was just shaking his head. It wasn't surprising, it was just disappointing that it
exactly.
was happening again.
Yeah.
And Popovic, after the first penalty was denied, he was just smiling hopelessly towards the camera. Everybody was nobody was surprised or outraged at first, but it was shit, it's happening again.
We're having one of those. Popovic is not new to that, right? He was banned for stating the truth.
He lost his shit when it was two penalties denied, three penalties denied. That's when he could not take it anymore. And he acted out. But first time he was it's happening again.
Yeah, we're here again.
It's a very bad sign that even the coaches, even the players have come to expect bad decisions. Ashley Westwood was talking about, we just want to see good refereeing when ATK were playing Bengaluru FC. So that should not be where we should be as a footballing nation. That before a match, the coaches are not talking about I hope my players give 200% or whatever. I just hope the referee is
good.
Please not again. It's a bit sad.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, we kind of got together a lot of games together because that's how interesting they were, whether it was Churchill Minerva, whether it's Naroka and Kerala, or East Bengal Indian Arrows, because they are in the race. You can still call them there in the title race. We also spoke about Pune and Kerala. Now, we'll take a short break here, but on the other side, we have some more interesting stuff, because some things don't happen the way you want, right? Kevin knows what I'm talking about. Only if this you could see his face right now.
I want to disappear in the second half.
We're going to touch upon that big game. And if you don't know what it is, wait for it. We'll come back to the second half. All of the more fun and banter on the other side of the break.
Hi, I'm Amit Verma, the host of the weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen. In my show, I examine the seen effects and the unintended consequences of public policy and private action. I show how policies meant to help the poor often end up hurting the poor. I've done episodes so far on demonetization, GST, surgical strikes, immigration, and MRP. And I will continue my forensic assault on the truth in the weeks to come.
Catch the show every Monday on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you prefer. Or visit seenunseen.in for all the latest updates.
Welcome back, guys. And if you're still guessing on what I spoke about before we slip into a short break, for those who got it, good enough. But for those who didn't hear it, I'm breaking it to you. Shillong Lajong played Mohun Bagan. And while we were previewing, somebody was very confident that we're going to... I mean, it's good to be confident, right? As in, there's nothing to lose any which way. So just go and say that Shillong will beat Mohun Bagan. But certain things don't happen the way you want it, Kevin. 3-0 victory to Mohun Bagan. I think Chiranjit will be happy beaming here. So, but it was good to see Akram and Fayaz. Was it Fayaz who got the other goal as well?
Yeah, to be
on the score sheet, because they deserved it. And we've seen them from the moment they are on the pitch. They've been amazing for Mohun Bagan. So, also kudos to the Bimal Magar. That's his name. The new lad, the Nepali lad that Mohun Bagan signed. He was also seen on the pitch later in the second half. So, Chiranjit, I'm coming to you. Happy?
Yeah, of course. When was the last time Mohun Bagan won in Shillong? I don't even remember. It's probably like 4 seasons out or something. And back then, Shillong Lajong were very different from how they are now. It was arguably a much weaker Shillong Lajong comparatively. So, not just the 3 points. Of course, the 3 points are appreciated. The 3 goals are appreciated. Getting Akram off his bad patch of just coming close and missing time after time, that's good. Sheikh Fayaz deserved the goal after the kind of shifts that he has been putting in. My happiness or my satisfaction from the match is centered around how Mohun Bagan kept the shape in the midfield, attacked up the middle, and still the wings are functioning properly. I have not seen Mohun Bagan have a comprehensive, wholesome attack since, I think, the 2015-16 season. You know, when the emphasis just shifted much more towards Sonny Norde and the people in Mohun Bagan squad, what worked for them in 2014-15, what won them the league. So, I think we're seeing a much more wholesome team now. It's just working better than I have ever seen in recent times. So that was a good thing. They were not intimidated. The weather, the altitude, everything was a challenge for them. And it just sort of saw them push through the barriers. Shillong Lajong were not doing that bad, by the way. Like Mohun Bagan were in trouble with multiple set pieces, and Shilton Paul was probably, again, he's just probably having his best season in his career. So all of that is super satisfactory. And I'm gonna pass to Kevin now, who's gonna give us his opinions on the match.
Kevin, I thought you were disappearing.
I wish I could. It was a crushing defeat. No doubt the youngsters of Mohun Bagan actually stepped up. The signings were so good. I think they're making sense as of now. They're back in the race, I would say. Total failure from Shillong Lajong. Not a moment that you can determine that this was the turning point. There was one mini chance, I would say, that was excellently saved by Shilton Bowler just before the halftime. That was Samuel's shot that was going in. I don't think it would have made a difference if the halftime score would have been 1-1. Because, Mohun Bagan knew what they were doing and they were more comfortable on the pitch. Shillong Lajong really didn't get off to any start. So 2 goals that came in the second and the third goal were quite late. You could have expected a 1-0 finish, but the way Mohun Bagan played, I felt the 3-0 was deserving. A lot more chances created than those 3 goals. Shillong Lajong, I really don't want to spoil
it's
the
okay.
mood by talking.
It's okay. Things happen. Shit happens in life. But since we're sticking to I-League, let's talk about the other game that happened since we spoke about the others. Let's just talk about this as well. Chennai versus ISL FC. It was a 1-1 draw. Surprised there, Kevin?
Chennai City. they've managed to pull some upsets this season. Mohun Bagan was one of them. Just looking at ISL, they're just not there anymore. So we will see a new champion, obviously, as well. Not even getting to a place where, you know, last season, where we thought, this is the point where they're going to, break away. But it's just, falling apart for Ezhel FC, especially the time when they came back from the Champions League. I don't think it's hurt them so much that they want to do well in the I-League. It does happen when a team, last season, they didn't have anything else to play apart from the I-League. Obviously, the Federation was, Federation Cup was afterwards.
Right.
Mohan Bagan also was caught in that situation. So this does happen to a team if you're not sorted, your plans ahead. ISL FC is just caught up in that, they've lost the Champions League, now the AFC Cup that they look forward to. So I-League may obviously will take a hit, and it's already showing in their game.
Yeah.
But great play by Chennai City.
Absolutely. So like we always like to compare things here, right? So we compare ISL with Leicester City winning it, the thing. So you can compare right now also. Even we don't know where Leicester City is roaming around the points table. So yeah, we'll have a new champion in Premier League as well. Siranjit, coming to you. Chennai versus ISL FC. Chennai being the usual candidates for, just like Churchill, for party purpose there.
Yeah, well, I still think Chennai City are your prime candidates for relegation, and this will be especially disappointing for them because they needed that. They went out knowing that a win gives them an advantage in the relegation race and puts ISL FC in danger here. So, look, ISL FC are playing in Asia for the first time. Okay, and this is the first time I think since they joined I-League that they had to think about two or three competitions simultaneously. So it's not easy, the strategizing is very different, the quality of play is very different, what you ask of your players is very different, and we have seen Mohan Bagan falter, we have seen Bengaluru FC falter, trying to manage these two very different competitions at the same time, and they they're used to doing it. They've been doing it for a few years back to back. ISL FC doing it for the first time, especially playing that away match in such challenging circumstances. You could see that they're just not ready. Iran was a bit cold. You go over to Coimbatore, not the coldest place out there, playing an afternoon game. It's understandable that they would not be 100%, and somehow Chennai City can take a little bit of advantage against them. I would be surprised if Chennai City, if ISL FC return to their full potential before they come back home. Actually, they're playing Churchill Brothers next, which is the worst opponent to have to face right now. Because just on a song, four wins out of five matches, it seems like all the momentum that was with Shillong Lajam got taken out and got put into Churchill Brothers. But at some point, you have to hope that when they're facing Naroka or Indian Arrows, they will hopefully bounce back towards the middle of this month.
Okay.
So it's just what Mohan Bagan suffered for, last season. They did not have enough squad depth to address both Asia and I-League. Bengaluru FC had, and Bengaluru FC still have this time, which is why their squad for AFC and ISL is so different.
Yeah.
Because you just don't want to divide up the players like that.
Yeah.
So that's what's happening with ISL FC, and they will pay the price a little a little bit at a time over the next couple of games, I think.
Okay. That's a good baton passed on, because the next one I was coming to was Bengaluru FC, who took on ATK, and they played on 3rd Feb with Saturday, and birthday boy Gurpreet Singh took charge, and he kept a clean sheet. I mean, I think that was the best gift that he could give himself, to keep clean sheet and also get those 3 points from ATK. Now, Kevin, We didn't talk about this much but ADK just looked like a little very vulnerable, especially the first goal that they just gave away. Sad stuff, right? When you're already hitting a low and then you happen to play the table toppers and then you score and then you gift them a goal. Shitty things happening for ADK.
They weren't all that bad. It's just that the frame of mind is not there. I think as you should have started this review by saying, go green. Bengaluru FC making statements all around. But they were just too fragile in front of a strong Bengaluru FC. You put anyone in such a place, it's going to be a tough match. But Bengaluru FC, you know, they know what they're doing. They're just able to score from any angle. And there were a couple of moments where Gurpreet was tested. So that really showed you it's way difficult to get past this Bengaluru FC, I would say, the wall. They do have a dynamic defense where, you know, it translates automatically from a three-man to a five-man. ATK have not been able to get that flow going for themselves. I feel sad for Ashley Westwood. He deserves much better than this. We thought it would be a great face-off between Albert Roca and Ashley Westwood. But when you don't have the squad matching each other's strengths, it's going to be difficult. However capable a manager is, he just doesn't have the team to put up a fight against such a strong side like Bengaluru FC. And it was expected to some extent that it's going to be a crushing defeat, but not in a manner that, you know, ATK put up a show. It was not there for them.
And I think there could be more goals, you know, because there were some good saves by Devjit as well. And not just that, even their defenders were good. You remember the Ashutosh clearing of those being in the touchline? Man, that was insane shot, and he kept it out. Chiranjit, coming to you, worries for ATK. Meanwhile, BFC has just, you know, fixed their spot on the top of the points table.
Yeah, well, BFC just had to play their natural game, and you knew that ATK were never going to be a match up to that.
So
that was it.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was, in the end, a very unremarkable game in the sense that nothing out of the ordinary happened, and it just went the way it's still supposed to end. Since we see so many games where so many things go wrong, it just seems like, you know, an abnormal night of normal. So, it was a rather easy game for BFC. They should just take that win and go home and worry about the next game.
Okay, then. Well, belated birthday wishes to Gurpreet Singh Sindhu as well. Hopefully, he'll give us some more great memories for us to cherish, all of the Indian football fans. And moving on, Goa took on Northeast United, the final match that happened. And that's the last match that we'll also be talking about on the show. Well, a crazy end to the weekend, and what a performance from Northeast United. Again, a team that knows how to spoil others' parties, right? I mean, Goa had a great chance to bounce back into the top four, but Northeast said, hey, you're not doing that. We ain't going to do that so easily right here. But 2-2 draw, a good result for Northeast United. Early setback for FC Goa with Brandon Fernandes, you know, being taken out. He looked really bad, in a bad pain, Kevin.
FC Goa, you know, they have so many goal creators. That's the biggest strength, I feel. Even if Brandon is not in the field, you see them creating so many chances from all around. And Northeast United, I think they want one team which waited for the attacks to go one-sided. They were waiting for the attacks to come their way and then respond. And that's how the game went. FC Goa took the lead first, and then Northeast United had a reply to that. Now that's a good sign of progress, but unfortunately it was the end of the season. So it won't matter too much unless they get wins out of these close games. Yes, towards the end we did feel like it might be a close, you know, win. It's going to be a 3-2. In the end, both teams look settled for that one point. FC Goa had, you know, slowed down their game considerably, looking at the long journey that they have, you know, next going forward now. For Northeast United, I would say it's still a decent result considering how they've been in the tournament so far. So it's just a comeback for them, but it's not enough for them to pull back into the top four.
Yeah, Chiranjit, a great performance from Northeast, but too late. But then once again, I mean, they've kind of put a little stop and to FC Goa's run to top four. But considering FC Goa has games in hand, so do you think they can still make it?
Yeah, it was more or less a bad patch, continuation of the bad patch that has been plaguing them in recent times. This was a game they should have won, of course, going by how they had been just keeping up recently. But look, it's just, it just seems like their emphasis on attack is leaving them vulnerable sometimes. So we saw against Mumbai City, they so often just allowed too much space to the opening team's strikers in the defense, which is why Mumbai City kept coming back and taking away their lead all the time, and then got to win. Again, this was a case that they kept getting the lead and losing it. So there is a huge balance happening between the intensity of the attack and defense, and now that they are going to Bengaluru, might come back to haunt them a little bit. But I think there is a change of attitude that might get them out of this fix. It's because they were playing at home and they had that calculation ready. You know that we got to play against Bengaluru and Chennai in February, mid February. So let's go all out to get full points from these home games against Mumbai City and Northeast United, both of which you assume at this point are not very near the consideration for top four. So that's what they did. The coach put all his eggs in that attacking socket, and they got had for not being cautious enough in the defense. When they're going out to play against Bengaluru away, I think they will be much more cautious in the defense. Hmm. You know, they will even be able to risk a draw.
Hmm.
When they're playing Chennai FC at home, they will also be much more cautious. So,
yep.
I think what these two games were, what especially this last night was for FC Goa, is a bit of a lesson in terms of how to play, how to weigh different options and keep your arsenal spread throughout the pitch and not just emphasize on one department. And hope that, okay, everything else will work out. So,
yeah.
I think you will see a very different FC Goa.
Okay.
Forward.
Interesting times ahead, because we have some mouthwatering classes coming your way. I mean, in ISL and I-League. So, since it's nearing the end, we are all eager to know what's going to happen in ISL, who's going to make the top four, and I-League, who will be the champions, all coming your way. This month is going to be very exciting, and hopefully we get some more interesting stories and stuff for all the Indian football fans listening to our show. Now, that's it. We end the show here. We also have an exclusive interview with FC Goa head coach Sergio Ribeiro. It'll be up on our website, thefangrass.com. Do check out to know more about it. Check the website, thefangrass.com, and follow the TFG football Twitter handle. You can also talk to us directly if you want to, or if you don't, it's okay. I mean, still, we are available. That's all I'm trying to say. Chiranjeet Oja, Bose_Kevin, SujiMatthew94. Like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We've crossed 900. That's a great news. Help us reach the 1,000 mark as well, and more. We promise we'll get you some more interesting stuff in football and other sports that we cover. Have a great day, guys. Enjoy. Cheers. Come back to us tomorrow, because once again, this week looks interesting in Indian football. Have a great day. Enjoy. Bye-bye.
There she stands, a podcast addict. Outside the bank, having travelled several miles to get in with other poor souls like her. The journey, though daunting for this youngling, will have some comfort because she has downloaded her favorite podcast. You can see more of her species on ivmpodcasts.com, your one-stop destination where you can check out the coolest Indian podcasts. Happy listening.